Today I rise to speak in support of my substitute for House Resolution 228. The ideas presented in the resolution offered by my colleague from the 106th District affirm the work of the Michigan PFAS Action Response Team and that it should be done in a way that ensures the most impactful and relevant decisions in the use of funds in the supplemental budget the legislature passed recently. I believe this resolution to be well-intentioned and a step in the right direction. However, the framework it is proposing could be stronger. For instance, in the resolution, the Scientific Advisory Committee established to ensure this money is used properly is to be comprised of experts from government, academia, and industry whose backgrounds include experience with PFAS, but it lacks any representation that would speak solely in the public interest. There are many unfortunate examples of situations where the government and industry have not acted in the best interest of the public, and I would hope we, as representatives of the government, would welcome more accountability to the people that we serve. A member of the advisory group who does not feel the obligation to defend the actions of a department or a municipality or a business would be an important voice in ensuring PFAS contamination is addressed in a way that puts the health and well-being of people first. Second, the resolution calls for an advisory committee to come up with a logical plan to guide agencies' efforts going forward and allow for stakeholder review and input from industry, academia, and nonprofit organizations. While I'm sure those parties have valuable input, I find it unacceptable that any list of stakeholders would not include individuals and businesses that are immediately impacted by PFAS contamination. It is not only appropriate, but essential to have the voices of individuals and family members who have been impacted by the diseases and disorders, both those known and suspected, to be caused by these damaging chemicals at the table where decisions are being made. It is essential that businesses that are impacted by the contamination be at that table as well. How can we properly address this without considering the impact on local restaurants whose customers now think twice before eating there, or the brewery who depends on clean water to make their product, or the daycare center that uses well water? We must take seriously their concerns and interests as well, whether they have analytical chemistry, environmental fate, and other complex knowledge of the issues related to the PFAS contamination or not. My final concern is that these resolutions wrongly double down on the previously stated commitment to a standard of 70 parts per trillion allowable PFAS in our drinking water.
Members, we have a colleague addressing the body. The chair recognizes Representative Brinks.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. This standard simply allows far too much poison in our drinking water. We should be considering the lessons from other states that have been working on this longer than we have. Minnesota, New Jersey, Vermont have all adopted or proposed much lower maximum levels in their water based on their review of the science, health impacts, and human costs they've observed in their communities, and many other states are looking to do the same. Rather than reaffirming a commitment to an EPA advisory standard that has been determined by other states to be insufficient to protect human health, we should join these other states in leading the nation in our response. By implementing a limit that takes a more precautionary stance, rather than wait for the list of damaging conditions to grow longer and longer before we take action. The people of Michigan deserve to have access to clean water. They deserve the assurance that their state and local elected leaders are ensuring that when they turn on the tap and give their kids a glass of water, that it will not make them sick. Our response to this contamination will have an impact on the health of our people of our state for decades to come. I'll support this resolution offered by my colleague, but let's be clear. This is a missed opportunity, and we could have done better. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.